Everybody, thank you very much for joining us here today. There's 137 of you for now. I'm sure that number will increase again. I will just get started by sharing some very simple housekeeping rules. Of course, as you know, you should be keeping your microphones on mute when you are not speaking. But this is also aiming to be an interactive webinar. So please do share questions in the chat if you have any. We'll monitor the chat, and we have a Q&A session later in the webinar where we'll be able to address all of your questions. Keep in mind that this webinar is being recorded, so we will be able to share the recording and the presentation on our website at the link that you see on the screen, probably by tomorrow. Thank you very much again, and I now leave the floor to our Executive Director, Dr. Balwant Singh, for a very quick welcome message.
Thank you very much, Barbara, and a very good morning, good afternoon, or good evening to all of you who've taken time to join us today. Welcome to this Sphere webinar, which explores the application of Sphere standards in urban settings, even more relevant now with complex crises such as COVID-19, which affect all types of settings. Some of you may know Sphere well, but some of you may be not so familiar with Sphere. The Sphere believes that people affected by crises must be at the center of decisions about humanitarian protection, assistance, recovery, and resilience. They have the right to prompt, effective, and quality humanitarian assistance, which enables them to survive crises, rebuild their lives, and recover their livelihoods with respect and dignity. This webinar is a first for Sphere to support the launch of an implementation guide. We are likely to do this more often in future. We have gained considerable experience delivering webinars over the past 6 months and found that this enables us both to reach more Sphere users, but also add to our learning from a wider audience. Today, we are launching our most recent implementation guide, Sphere for Urban Settings. And we would like to explore one of the most difficult issues when it comes to working with global standards, that of applying standards meaningfully in a specific context. And when talking about urban settings, are definitely a highly complex setting altogether. It's my pleasure now to introduce my colleague Aninia Nadig, who will facilitate this webinar. Aninia joined Sphere in 2008 and leads our policy and practice work and also coordinates the Humanitarian Standards Partnership. Over to you, Aninia.
Thank you, Balwant. Many thanks and welcome, everybody. I will do my best to lead you through this webinar today. And I wanted to start by indeed briefly covering the objectives of this webinar, which are to share information on the Sphere Handbook and its application in urban contexts. It is to draw attention to the new guide, as Balwant just mentioned. It is also to share some positive examples and best practices in the implementation of standards in urban settings, urban environments. And the last item is to defy the myth that Sphere standards are not really so much applicable in urban settings. We will have a number of people talking today, which I will introduce as we go along. And at the very beginning, I would like to look at the polls that you just started to fill in. And it's actually always interesting for us to see who our audience is. So we're trying to gauge that a little bit. The first question that we posed to you was, how often do you use Sphere standards during your work? It's nice to see that most of you do sometimes use them or even often, and the minority only responded never. I hope that we can, you know, interest you in Sphere sufficiently that you will pick up the handbook as well in the future. And the second question was, how often do you use the Sphere standards while working in an urban context? There, the nevers are a bit higher, the oftens a bit lower, and the sometimes as well. So maybe it is the fact that the urban application of the standards is not as as frequent as working with them in other contexts. So that makes this webinar quite relevant. And I would like to start by, hang on,
We have another poll.
Yes. So the other poll we wanted to suggest before we really get into the meat of things is each kind of environment you work, so that we also have a better sense again of who our audience is and how many of you actually work in urban contexts and what kinds of urban contexts. So most of you work in the office, so do we, especially now. Countryside is quite high, planned settlements, spontaneous settlements are a bit lower, towns or cities, some of you do, some 36%. So again, not many of you actually do work at this moment, or a majority does not work in urban settings at this moment. That's good for us to know. Again, hoping that this webinar will provide you some new insights. As Balwan said, Sphere does apply to all contexts because it is built on universal rights that apply everywhere. And I was quite happy to see that we got two comments at the outset of the webinar who said, well, why are we talking about demystifying this myth? Why do we even think that there's a myth that Sphere does not apply to urban settings? It does, but there have been consistently voices that say, well, that the standards don't really work in urban settings. Again, urban is a very specific context with very specific knowledge required to work in it, as is the case with any other context as well. And I do not want to minimize the complexity of an urban context. So there is a challenge of how to assess actual needs. There's a challenge of working maybe in an area-based way that is less specifically focusing on people. There's the challenge of coordination with a different kind, with a larger number maybe of stakeholders in a very complex, dense context. I don't want to take those challenges away, but they should be acknowledged, but they don't mean that humanitarian standards don't apply. And so the other thing is that sometimes people say, yeah, but there's indicators in the Sphere Handbook, you know, 15 liters per person per day, 3.5 square meters of covered living space. They don't make sense in a, or queuing time for getting water. They don't make sense in an urban context. And here, I just want to say that if we can go to the next slide. Many people, unfortunately, focus a lot on the indicators in the handbook. And indicators are important, but they don't exist in isolation. What they do is they support the standards that are qualitative outcome statements based on rights. And neither the standards nor the indicators, even taken together, are, you know, somewhere in mid-space, because the indicators, to develop them, to apply them, to contextualize them, you need the next slide, which are the foundation chapters of Sphere and Sphere's guidance notes. And even those are not, you know, invented in thin air. Everything is based on context, a knowledge of context, And so instead of looking at indicators and then thinking, what do we do with these indicators? We need to take a step back and understand that everything we do is based on context and then feeds the indicators which are contextualized, and they then allow the standards to be fulfilled. And so Sphere is not about 15 liters of water per person per day, and it's not about 3.5 square meters of covered living space, which are some of the metrics in the indicators, but Sphere is about people having equitable and affordable access to sufficient quantity of safe water, for example, to meet their needs. Or it is about people having access to a safe and adequate living space that allows them to live a life with dignity. And the other important part I need to mention is that all those standards, those technical standards, are built on Sphere's foundation chapters, which are the humanitarian charter, the protection principles, and the core humanitarian standard, which all put people and communities at the center. And as one of our speakers, Schumann, said very aptly yesterday in a discussion, those are values that don't need extra funding, but that are really based on a mindset. So if standards are well developed, which I hope Sphere standards are, then those standards will be able to absorb, to deal with the tensions between very different kinds of contexts and still provide useful guidance on what needs to be in place for people to survive and recover with dignity. With that, I would like to move to the next step, which is I'm delighted to introduce the first round of speakers to you. They will present three examples of working with standards in urban contexts. And the first speaker will be Camille Erdem-Güler. He is the coordinator of community-based programs for the Turkish Red Crescent, focusing on protection, livelihoods, psychosocial support, and social inclusion activities. And before this position, he was working with the international operations of the Turkish Red Crescent in Gaza and Somalia. He also worked for UNHCR and several think tanks, and is one of the Sphere focal points in Turkey. And as such, he also works on disaster risk reduction and community resilience. The second speaker we'll have is Zeynep Sanduvac. She lives in Istanbul, also Turkey-based, and she has been part of the Sphere community since 2009, mostly as an independent Sphere trainer. Zeynep applied the Sphere standards in different countries and different contexts, including Turkey, Gaza, Tanzania, Ethiopia, Bangladesh, and others. She's currently a board member of the Nirengi Association in Istanbul, and this local NGO is actually a member of Sphere. And Zeynep is also a Sphere focal point in Turkey. The third speaker we have is Schumann Afsanul Islam. He is the director of the Humanitarian Leadership Academy in Bangladesh, based in Dhaka. He has been working in DRR and with disaster risk reduction and in the humanitarian sector for over 25 years. And this includes working with Oxfam, DFID, Save the Children, CARE, BRAC, and also Terre des Hommes in Bangladesh. He contributed to the development of the HAP standard in 2006 and played an important role in promoting and translating the Sphere standards into Bangladesh, and also establishing the Sphere Community Bangladesh, which is also quite important Sphere focal point. Schumann is a Sphere trainer and has been for many years. With this, I would like to hand over to Camille. Let's start with Camille. and his discussion of applying sphere standards in urban settings. Over to you, Camille. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Anina. So, good morning, everyone. So I will be briefly telling you how we use the sphere standards in the urban setting within the context of COVID-19. So that I will do my best to demystify the facts that are lying with this use of sphere in the urban settings. So that, I mean, there are a couple of different occasions that we had a chance to use of sphere, but before passing to get into the details, I will just briefly inform you on the context that we are working. So Turkey is a country that is consisting of around 100 million people, and there are 5 million refugees inside the country. And as far as the statistics are saying, 70% of the Turkish population is living in the urban settlements. So that it is, the context could be considered as a quite urban space. And apart from that, it is prone to various disasters, including earthquake, flood, and now very recently we have that migration crisis, so that it brings us a complex complex humanitarian crisis at the end of the day. And so let me just briefly tell you how we are trying to cope with sphere through using the COVID-19 through using the sphere standards. Can we just start the presentation? Yes. So first thing that we are doing is the assessment. And in case you would check the document that is supplementary to the sphere manual, that is referring to the minimum standards for applications to the urban settlements. The assessment is the core start, the core element that should be done at the beginning of the usage of sphere. So that what we did is we started a rumor tracking system, and constantly we are trying to do that. We conducted an assessment, and it is published. You can check it through that website. I also posted the link, or you can contact me for the for further information. So that it is called as knowledge attitudes and knowledge attitudes assessment on COVID-19, and it was conducted through Turkish Red Crescent's communication channels, in which includes social media platforms, phone interviews. We have a very big call center, and we conducted that study with around 4,000 people overall. And we collected qualitative and quantitative data. Then we just realized that there had been various rumors about COVID-19. And one of them was vinegar and garlic and onions. I mean, most of the people were considering at the beginning of the COVID-19 that could be preserving us from COVID-19. And no surprise for this, most of the governments, including World Health Organization, was claiming that there is no need to use mask, and mask could be detrimental for the human health at the beginning of the COVID-19. And it is also tragic that we can see the shift, we can see the trends of the COVID-19 that has been evaluated from the time being. Then we pass to our beneficiaries. I mean, we are providing support to more than 2-3 million people inside the country. That's the most of them are refugees, actually. And through these assessments, we were trying to understand what were the needs of COVID. I mean, what how the COVID affected their daily life. One of them was the schooling. I mean, they were not able to go to schools. Debts was another thing because it was affecting the socioeconomic structure of their life. They were not able to reach to medical services. I mean, 22% of the of our beneficiaries were not able to reach to medical services that were applied in their households. We tried to understand how is our community and how they should be, how we should be making some changes through our services. And then the third one was the relying on the communities, and we were conducting the usually we are conducting these advisory board meetings, and we are trying to understand what they are expecting from our services. For the response side, we are working on the protection mainstreaming and response. Since due to the COVID precautions, there are very few organizations that are working on the field level, so that we are doing protection work. That means we are trying to support people to access to the basic services that the Turkish government is providing. And also, we are providing cash support for, around 1.8 million people inside the country. And there are also some complementary elements that were supporting our cash program, actually, like rental issues, socioeconomic support, but it was also going through the cash mechanism, vouchers as well. But in any case, Turkey is a country that has a strong and efficient banking system so that it could be maintained. And you can see the more details in the complementary guideline, how the cash mechanism should be functioning at the minimum level. And livelihood support can be also considered as an element because most of the people were facing with unemployment. And in order to support both to the labor market and the employees, we were trying to support people to profile and link them to the market requirements. So that this was a usual task that we were doing, but at the end of the day, we really needed to support these people that were standing out of the labor market. We can pass to next presentation. Yeah, the thing is, what we saw is actually, I mean, this is most probably you have that in your mind as well, and this is one of the things, and we really need to go further details on the COVID-19 effects, because what we realized is digitalization is not an option anymore. It is a service that that people should be accessing, and in the urban settlements, it is quite unfortunate that most of the people are still not able to access to internet or to online channels. And education was one of the problems inside Turkey, but there are also problems in most of the countries because children were not able to access to educational services. So that at the end of the day, I guess we will really need to consider that whether we should be taking into consideration that the digitalization might be a minimum standard or not. But this will be definitely bringing us to another value set. This is part of the sustainable development goals, and also it is quite important to understand communities, what they are needing and what they really wants to embrace. While we are supporting people in the urban settings. What we were thinking is, what I can say for anyone that would say that Sphere is useless document for the urban settings, like in Brussels, in Geneva, what I can say is the understanding of urban has shifted with the COVID-19, because we get all vulnerable with the COVID. I mean, the people that are in front of their computers are mostly at their homes, and it is what I call is a small detention. Within that small detention, people are stuck in these places, and they are not able to interact, so that we are all vulnerable. And we really need to cope with that and understand that. But I really don't think that Sphere can be out of the question while we are providing humanitarian support to the communities. So these are all that I wanted to reflect, but if you have any questions, we will be discussing on the questions and answers level, I guess. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much, Camille. That was extremely interesting. You raised the issue of assessments, and you provided some suggestions of doing assessments involving the communities. Very interesting, in a different way, and suggestions for new standards, for new ways of working, for the intersectoriality of standards. Very, very important, and we take note of that, and I'm sure, I mean, guidance always evolves, fortunately, to adapt to new challenges as we identify them and as we're faced by those challenges. I would like to hand over now to Zeynep, who will also talk to us about situations in Turkey. Very much looking forward to that. Over to you, Zeynep. Thank you.
Thank you, Aninia. And good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to all. I will share some reflections, Sphere MS in urban settings from different perspective, from different stakeholders' perspective in Turkey. So thank you, Vasilia, this slide. It was a nice coincidence that right before I got the invitation for joining this webinar, I had already scheduled at 10th and 11th December for delivering an online Sphere MS training to the stakeholders who were working mostly in Istanbul, from the international organization to the national organizations and some community initiative members. So it was really participatory program. So this gave me a chance to get real-time information from the participants about the Sphere. Additionally, I conducted a focus group discussion with this different stakeholders' representatives, especially mostly, I can say, key informants. And also I did a desk review in Sphere in Turkey. During all these data gathering process, I focused on 3 points: people's awareness of the Sphere handbook, people access to the Sphere handbook, people's use of the Sphere handbook. So next slide, please. 28 people I interviewed, all of them have been working in urban settings. Almost all of them, to varying degrees, had heard of the Sphere handbook. All have an access to the online version of the Sphere handbook. 1/3 28 people I interviewed said that their organization have been using Sphere MS. Even some of them have limited knowledge of it, but they said their organization is applying Sphere, and they would like to get more, how can they involve deeply for the applying of Sphere with proper knowledge. So as to Turkish versions availability in Turkey, Sphere handbooks 2000-2004, 2011 versions are available in Turkish. We will have the 2018 version soon, mostly first quarter of the 2021, we will have it. As to desk review, I found that Sphere Handbook 2000 version is still being used. It was really a surprise for me too, I can say. Especially by academia, mostly by departments of architecture and engineering. I found that some academicians from this department reference the Sphere Handbook in their articles. Also, Sphere Handbook 2000 version is being used by municipalities staff or consultant. These are big cities municipalities, including Istanbul, Izmir, where the third biggest of Turkey. So the mostly the engineers and architects working in the urban plannings, urban planning units of municipalities also cited the 2011 version of Sphere Handbook in their reports, specifically about the addressing the specification of the assembly areas or evacuation areas in any emergencies. Also, it was interesting. Additionally, Turkish Red Crescent Nutrition Guideline in 2017 highly referenced to Sphere's MS. Some of the participants of the workshop participants also mentioned that their organization have been using this guideline for nutrition response. Next slide, please. There should be one slide, but still I can say, Vasilya, could you just check if there is one more slide? No. Okay. I can. Thank you for trying. Okay, I can continue with this. actually, based on what I have told so far, I think you have gotten the idea what there was no query that Sphere MS would be more appropriate to be used in rural camp environment compared to the urban environment. I may give a few tangible examples about the Sphere MS in urban settings. Maybe we can go previous one. You can go previous one, please. Okay, food security and nutrition. Yes, thank you. First example is from the food security and nutrition, the page 215, actually. There is a standards, seventh standards, livelihood standards. And 7.2 income and employment substandards. Key action says that choose type of payment, in-kind, cash, voucher, food, or combination based on a participatory analysis. Also, there was another substandard is continue, understand local capacities, safety and protection benefits, immediate needs, equitable access, existing market system, and affected people's preference. My participants actually join in my online workshop. One or two organization representatives provided immediate example about choosing of types of payment. Regarding cash transfer, one example is that in terms of using of mobile phones based on the affected people's preference, that the organization is sending digital code through text message for the cash transfer. It totally aligns with the Sphere standards in urban setting guidelines. If you look at the figure 6, see in the lower right corner, urban advantages part. It asked that if mobile, ATMs, internet, and point of sale networks are functioning. Also, there is another question about the if there are security risks and so on. So in our example, the organization used the urban advantages based on the affected people's preference for cash transfer. So it was really nice to see the alignment with the target group, organization's approach, and the Sphere MS application in the urban settings. So another example is from the shelter and settlement. Next slide, please. Thank you. Now we are on the right track. Thank you, Vasilia. And standard six, I would like to give example from the standard six, security of tenure. The affected population has security of tenure in its shelter and settlement options. In terms of the key action four, implement shelter and settlement programs to support security of tenure. And it continue, ensure that documentation such as tenure agreement is properly prepared by and reflects the rights of all parties. Again, one of the organization representative exactly described 4.2 as saying that legal assistance is being provided to the affected people for ensuring the rental agreements properly prepared and protects the tenant's rights against the landlord or rental agencies. I think I can provide more example, but I think you got the idea. The legend about the minimum standards mostly suitable for the rural area or camp setting, it is not valid, at least in Turkey, and the organizations is working in here. So I can stop now. And if there is a question, I will be happy for answering it. Thank you. Aninia?
Thank you, Zeynep. Thank you very much. Very interesting, a different approach to the same issue, and a very interesting remark about which version of the handbook people use, because as we will see later with our next couple of speakers, the Sphere handbook, the latest version 2018, actually has made quite a significant effort to include urban guidance as well. And so it is important to work with the 2018, with the most recent handbook, and not with the previous version, because this version is stronger in all sorts of, for all sorts of various elements of urban response. And security of tenure is a very important element. You mentioned it became a standard because there are so many new ways of welcoming refugees and IDPs into urban settings. Thank you very much, Zeynep. And I'm handing over now to our last speaker. We move from Turkey to Bangladesh, and Shuman will also take us a little bit out of the humanitarian setting into urban response in a broader sense. Over to you, Shuman. Welcome.
Yeah, thank you very much, Niniana. Can you hear me?
We can.
Yeah, okay. Thank you once again giving this opportunity to me talking about the Sphere standard. As you have been saying, that I have been involved actually with this humanitarian and this Sphere thing. Since its beginning, from the very first version of this standard development and things, so I'll as you said that I'll be talking around this urban disaster response instead, kind of the urban humanitarian response. Well, we define this disaster emergency response that's coming from the any disaster from natural and man-made disasters, and humanitarian crisis is coming from this complex emergencies of refugees. So that's basically a kind of a working definition based on what I'll be elaborating my discussion. So examples I'm going to tell here, well, if not a very big disaster in the capital of Bangladesh, Dhaka, is a kind of the frequent emergency response or disaster response we do is a slum fire responses. Often in big slums, fire break out and hundreds of families sometimes lost their livelihoods and shelters, and organizations need to respond around those disasters. Well, it's a very difficult situations where people need response. And then I'll be very specific on talking about this, how Sphere standard Sphere standard been used on this emergency response in Bangladesh, disaster emergency response in Bangladesh. So as you started by saying that disaster, often when we talk about Sphere standard, people straightforward jumped onto the sectoral responses, for example, food, NFI shelter, and other things where they can touch it, measure it. That's require kind of the technical expertise or kind of a budget and everything. But the foundation and the principles of Sphere standard, as we say, are those the humanitarian standard, core humanitarian, humanitarian charters, humanitarian core humanitarian standard, and the protection principles. Whereas the core humanitarian standard is not only the foundation and principle, but also the standard for emergency response, where we don't need need budgets. It's only the mindset and the skills and the commitment and attitude. When I talking the examples of a slum fire response in Dhaka city, first of it it's come is a need assessment. Well, and the need assessments in slum fire responses in Bangladesh in Dhaka city is very much is go along with these fair standards. For example, it's joint effort, it's coordinated, and it responds to people's dignity and the need, and based on the right base approach and those things that been talking about the core humanitarian standard and the protection principles. It definitely involved the communities, including the local government representatives of around the slum areas. Talking about the protection principle, it is as long as I know organizations involved in immediate response are on the core of their designing response, looking at this child protection, do no harm, gender equalities, and all those things, and that very much kind of they integrated into their protection planning and protection designing, and also the beneficiary selection criteria that is very critical in humanitarian responses, where being very much impartial and independent and based on the need. Actually, prioritizing the people, the most vulnerable people, to be responded and to be supported. So those are the protection principles very much integrated in the slum responses. And then, if I come to kind of a sectoral response, for example, in most cases, humanitarian response in slum fires happened is distribution of non-food items. And again, it's based on the need assessment involved with the community people. Those are being coordinated among the organization and among the government so that people are not getting duplicated of the efforts and resources are used on the need and relief of the people, and above all these standards, that's very much talk about the distribution standards, where people are considering the disabilities of the people or delivering at their doorstep. For example, in case of COVID response, delivering their support at their doorsteps. So those are the examples, very specific. I can spell out from Bangladeshi Dhaka response as kind of the disaster emergency responses in Dhaka. And as I said, this need to be very much clear among the people that Sphere standard is not only the sectoral standards, it's not only the kg or meter or the numbers. It's about the core humanitarian standards. Sphere standard is about the protection principles, and that's what actually I time and again talk everyone when I have a chance to talk about, that concentrate on those things that doesn't need budget, but can create a huge impact on the vulnerable people's life when we do humanitarian or disaster emergency activities. Thank you very much for giving me this scope once again.
Thank you, Schumann. That was an awesome way of ending this first part of the webinar. A very strong advocacy for using Sphere, the Sphere Handbook, in a more comprehensive, more holistic way, and not just focusing on the technical standards. It's a really, really, really important element of working with the Sphere standards in a constructive, in a positive way. So I think those three, the three speakers we just heard had very complementary approaches to presenting Sphere in urban responses, in very different kinds of responses. We're now moving to the next part of our webinar. And it is my pleasure to have the two authors of the second urban guide that we're just launching now with us, Professor David Sanderson and Dr. Pamela Sitko. Before I hand over to them to give a bit of a reflection on what we've heard so far from their points of view, both in terms of what the new guide covers, but also in terms of what's now in the Sphere Handbook around urban guidance, I would like to just briefly look at those two guides that we're actually now presenting to the Sphere community. And you will also find them in the chat, the links to those two guides, and you see them here on the slide soon. Those two guides, the first one was written based on the previous Sphere Handbook, and it very much focuses on contextualizing Sphere standards. It focuses on the people-centered, on the protection and core humanitarian standard aspects of urban work. So very much those foundation chapters. And it has a very interesting checklist at the end for considering standards in urban contexts. What are the questions you should ask yourself in order to contextualize standards for urban contexts? The second guide, which we're launching today, was written, as I said, by David and Pam, and it has as a basis a Sphere Handbook that is more solidly referencing urban contexts, and that's why it can focus on different elements and is complementary to the first guide. It focuses a lot on tools and approaches that you can pick up. It has a very extensive last section, a reference section with lots of tools. It focuses on cash and markets, which we heard is important, on applying the standards in the technical chapters in WASH, shelter, health, nutrition, food security. How do we work in those for those chapters in urban settings? And it has, as I said, a broad annex with lots of tools suggested. Coming back to the two authors, Pamela Sitko, she is an urban resilience technical specialist with over 15 years experience in disaster development and conflict settings across 20 countries, very experienced. She worked with agencies such as UN Habitat, World Food Programme, IFRC, and various non-government organizations, including World Vision, Habitat for Humanity. And she holds a PhD in urban disaster resilience. In 2018, she led the integration of urban contexts into the Sphere Handbook during the handbook revision. And she currently works as a senior project officer for resilience in New South Wales, which is a state government disaster management agency in Australia. And I think right now we saw in the news, you are indeed dealing with some floods in your area. Professor David Sanderson has 28 years of experience working across the world in development and emergencies. He worked for 8 years for Care International UK as head of policy and then regional manager for Southern and West Africa. He was also director of CENDEP, a center at Oxford Brookes University, which focuses on development and emergencies. And for 1 year, he was full-time visiting professor at Harvard University. Since 2016, David is the inaugural Judith Nielsen Chair at the University of New South Wales. That's a long title, in Sydney. And he is a member of several NGO boards and committees, and is the author of the 2019 Good Practice Review by ODI and ALNAP on urban humanitarian response. May I hand the microphone over to you two, starting with David, with the question, how do you see the what we've heard so far reflected in the 2020, in the second part of the urban guidance that we published today? Over
Thanks,
to you, David.
Anina.
Thank you.
Firstly, thank you very much to Anina for putting this on, and thank you, Balwant, for a great introduction. And it was a huge privilege and pleasure to be part of this Sphere Part 2 Urban Guide. So thank you very much that we had, I speak for myself, not for Pamela, but the opportunity to be working on that. I think we heard from our first three speakers, great practice, practical, detailed experience. So rather than to repeat that, what I would like to suggest is sort of flying a little bit higher, so less of the granular detail, but some of the overview, because of course this thing is there to read and to look at your leisure. And also thank you everybody for joining and some friends on this call as well. Always nice to see old friends. So thanks, Sphere, for this. I think what is clear, and even saying this, you know, it gets riddled with, you know, controversy, but I would like to say what's clear is that an urban approach presents different challenges and opportunities compared to operations in non-urban settings, such as camps and also in rural areas. But that's not the only challenge we're facing right now in humanitarian response. And since we're at the end of 2020, it would be, I think, rather remiss a meeting like this if we didn't think about what's been happening with COVID. I think most people on this call may have seen OCHA's Global Humanitarian Overview for 2021, released on the 1st of December. And Mark Lowcock, the head of OCHA, writes at the front, the report warns 2021 could be the year of the grand reversal, the unraveling of 40 years of progress. And that's from someone who really knows what he's talking about. COVID-19 has triggered the deepest global recession since the 1930s. So to think that donor nations are going to be continuing funding things is going to be rather hopeful. Obviously, we all hope it will. But certainly where I'm from, the UK, we're seeing national interest prevailing and funding going down. For the first time since the 1990s, extreme poverty will increase, life expectancy will fall, and we know the links of that to chronic vulnerability leading to worsened disasters. Climate change in the last 10 years, the hottest on record, and forecasts are for more of the same. Stronger windstorms, increased flooding will follow. And at the same time, by this time next year, if predictions are correct, there'll be some 70 million new people living in cities. Most city growth around the world is actually people being born, it's not actually migration. I'm not saying this so we're all mired in gloom and think it's the end of things, because that's not been the history of humanity. It's not a council of despair. But what I'm arguing and, well, observing, not even arguing, is that we need to be more innovative and entrepreneurial, how we're going to respond to greater need with probably less funds. And that's a whole bundle of things, deciding what we're not going to do, what we're not going to be engaged in, all these different things. And so with that sort of 2-minute caveat, because this has been an extraordinary year, and maybe we never see the likes of 2020 again, I think is a safe thing to say. I'd like to underscore some of the things that are in this guide, this part two, which relate to that idea of being more innovative and more entrepreneurial, obviously with this urban lens that we're talking about tonight. And I think I've just got four or five sort of broad brush statements because the detail is in the report. There's no need to repeat that. The key overall approach is to work with the city. And that might seem a bit obvious, but actually to work with the city, that means use what it has to offer to be innovative and creative, to prioritize local skills, local abilities, local resources, not bringing things in when you can buy it locally, when you can source it nearby, assuming the city has stuff rather than assuming it doesn't. Again, a bit of an obvious thing, but I think we still fall into the thing of delivering goods and services. Maybe there's a case for that sometimes, but very often not. Actually, markets come very quickly after crises and even during, of course. I think an example would be post-disaster sheltering options that go beyond temporary shelters, which themselves have an element of discussion about their usefulness. Rentals, upgrades, staying with host families, repurposing buildings are all options that cities offer and agencies, a myriad agencies do, the DRC, the NRC, UN Habitat, others are of course already doing, not to suggest they're not. We can go vertically in the city in a way that we can't go in other crisis responses. And we can talk space, not just the assumption of a standard, standalone single shelter, which is not an urban form. Another is the use of cash, and we heard a bit about cash, for supporting, stimulating markets and improving people's agency, of course, that people get to decide how they use it. Now, I mean, as we all know, cash isn't perfect, but it's no less worse than other sectors and an awful lot better than many others for transaction costs. And in the city, it's an utter no-brainer to use cash in a city, recognizing its limitations, but actually it's really powerful and the evidence increases on that. And I think another one drawing from developmental heritages, and it was great to have Schumann give that Dhaka context, if ever there was a place of challenge and wonderful, opportunity, it is a city such as Dhaka. A key part is to support and not to provide. Humanitarian aid right now is based on the provision of goods and services. And of course that makes sense. It's not an argument against that because societies often need that in a crisis. But, in urban areas, it's different. The need in an urban area may be overwhelming. It's multifaceted, not that obvious and more complicated than it seems. To use the proverbial iceberg, it's the stuff you don't see, which is what really matters. Those social, those economic, those political things, those governance structures, many of which are hidden, many of which are open. All those different layers, gangs, non-state militias, all the others that are there part of the urban story very, very often. One example of many would be healthcare, where the provision of health support needs to be aware of and support the systems and practices that already exist. That doesn't mean you've got to build the hospitals or refix them or do stuff like that, but it does mean having an awareness of the different systems and the connectedness with just that seemingly on one level, seemingly simple healthcare support actually means in a city because it's all different kinds of levels. And knowing at least about that is a good point about where we're going to go. Supporting means working with who's there to get to where they need to be. And as the saying goes, whose disaster is it? Well, it's all of ours in a globalized world, of course, but it's first and foremost those in that city whose homes it is. And the role of aid is to support that. It means supporting authorities, local actors, and their decision-making processes. And as we know, local authorities almost all around the world are overwhelmed and under-resourced and imperfect. But our job needs to be support as far as possible. What can be done there? Another is meaningful engagement in complexity. In fact, this is my last point. Meaningful engagement in complexity. Cities are really complicated. And that's not an argument that rural is not. I'm not suggesting that, but cities are very complicated. And an issue there is ensuring the best investments are made, especially when we're gonna face the next few years of very painful times. The COVID crisis is many dozens of times worse than the global financial crash. And look what happened as a result of that. So we're hitting a time right now of really different stuff with more need. And I think we need to be real about that. Area-based approaches are within the urban guide, part two. and ABAs maybe are an example of engaging complexity, often led by the global shelter cluster, but of course not owned by them. It's multi-sectoral, it's bottom-up, it's post-crisis recovery, very consultative, participatory, cutting across. And that's really difficult. Just look at Red Cross's experiences, their candid experiences, and how they write about that, meaning it was real, meaning it was really hard. And some research that led up to this Sphere guideline, one person very memorably said to us, if there was an easy way to do this, we'd be doing it. But if your metric is around effective recovery, as opposed to spending budgets fast, then actually it's about this. But that's really hard and really complicated. But actually that's the urban story. It's difficult and complicated. And the great news is there are great tools that are developing, been developed. There's a lot of expertise. You know, World War II is pretty bad on cities. So it's not like it's a new phenomenon. But in the last 10, 15 years in particular, a lot's been done, not least the worker sphere, for part one and now part two, in terms of crafting what can we say meaningfully and tying into something with such a wealth and depth of experiences as the sphere standards, and saying urbanism, you know, and how do we talk urban in that? So I'll stop there and thanks very much.
Thank you, David. Thank you very much. Yes, it's an enormously complex setting. There will be more standards eventually developed around urban settings, I'm sure. And our two guides help already go in that direction and capture some of the knowledge and the learning that there is. I would like to hand over now to Pam, because you, Pam, you have had a very unique experience in actually integrating urban guidance into the current Sphere Handbook. And I would like you to just very briefly touch upon the key elements that are now in the handbook and how that makes the standards more easily contextualizable in urban settings. Over to you, Pam. Thank you.
Oh, thanks, Aninia. As Aninia said in the intro, I work for the New South Wales state government in Australia. So we've been doing a lot of bushfire recovery and response over the past year in smaller urban centres. And I'd like to speak tonight specifically to the people in the poll who indicated that they have never worked in urban environments or they haven't used Sphere in urban environments. And I'd like to encourage you to start with the introduction chapter of the Sphere Handbook. There's a really short, sharp paragraph about what is different about urban. And it highlights the fact that we face higher levels of density, density of people, density of infrastructure, density of laws, density of homes, a greater diversity, perhaps, diversity in politics, in ethnicity, in culture, in religion, and a dynamism. You know, cities are on the move, people are on the move. And so is power. Power is always shifting. So that first introduction really highlights some of those things. It points to what Kamal was saying and what David mentioned around cash. You know, we're paying cash for food, we're paying cash for rent, we're paying cash to access healthcare, and the role of local actors. I reflect that in the small towns, one of the apple picking towns here in Australia, New South Wales, there were a number of immigrant workers, and they were picking the fruit and the vegetables, and when the fires hit, they didn't know what to do or where to go, and the state government was helping respond, but we actually didn't know that those people were there. So it was the local actors, and they've got specialized skills. They are architects, they're planners, they're urban designers, they're engineers, and they're a really important part of the humanitarian response. And the bit about the integrated programming that David touched on earlier is also mentioned in the introduction. You know, it's about choosing an area and then responding with all sectors and not just taking a sector-based approach anymore. So you might have heard words like neighborhood approach or settlements-based approach, or indeed neighborhood-based approach. Don't know if I said that one first. So really it's around what local communities are demanding rather than what humanitarian actors are able to provide. So check out the intro chapter. Following that, there are four chapters that focus on sectors specifically. So you have the WASH chapter, water supply, sanitation, and hygiene promotion. Food security is another chapter, and nutrition. A third chapter on shelter and settlements, and a fourth on health. So if you work specifically in one of those sectors and you want to know what is different about an urban context, what are the key things that I should know about before I start, have a look at the introduction. It's very, very short and sharp. And let me give you an example with WASH. Let me just say that in the introduction, the chapter highlights community engagement can be challenging, especially when it comes to identifying at-risk populations in dense low-income settlements. The introduction chapter in the WASH section also talks about ownership and the importance of identifying, is it public, is it private ownership of the infrastructure, or is it somewhere in between in a combination? And it's really important to identify those things because it informs our response options and also the way in which we deliver our interventions. Let me talk for a moment to wrap up about standard 2.1 in the water supply, sanitation, and hygiene promotion chapter. And that's really around access and water quantity. Most people will be familiar with the minimum standard for water supply is 15 liters per person per day. And that's quite an established practice. Now, you'll find throughout the handbook and specifically in this chapter, a lot of tips and guidance in the guidance notes on urban. So the guidance notes for standard 2.1 says, and I'll just quote it here. It says, in an urban middle income context, 50 liters per person per day may be the minimum acceptable amount to maintain health and dignity. So that's quite a difference from 15. So I really encourage you as a practitioner to check out the guidance notes at the end of each of the chapters. And please know that these are guidance notes and that it changes and it varies. And it's up to the practitioner, up to the agency, up to the actor to make an informed choice based on assessments about what's the most appropriate standard. So thank you very much for including me tonight. I've enjoyed being here and look forward to your questions.
Thank you so much, Pam. Thank you for, again, making sure that we look at the Sphere guidance, at the Sphere standards in a holistic way. And the introduction chapters, I was there when they were written. They are so rich, introduction to the handbook, but also to each of the chapters, as you mentioned. And that's where really the wealth of information to contextualize is present. I want to now, happy to move to the third part of our webinar, which is a discussion involving the participants, everybody who has been patiently listening to us up till now. And I want to start with the first question that we received, and it links very well to what Pam just mentioned about local actors, the importance of local actors. And the comment says, I was a disaster management with New York City government for 5 years. What I find humanitarians who have worked primarily in rural or camp settings, what I find they miss is that urban dwellers will not wait for your help. They self-organize as individuals and in spontaneous groupings, and management of spontaneous volunteers and unsolicited non-food items is essential. So you enter into a situation that is actually already buzzing with response. I find that a very interesting comment. I don't know who would, I would like to just suggest that whoever of the five speakers who would like to respond just takes the microphone spontaneously.
You know, that was a huge issue here in Australia when urban areas burnt down. There was a lot of desire to help, and warehouses were erected to store all these non-food items, and the army was called in to manage some of it, and communities were overwhelmed, and their beautiful little halls and community centers were filled full of food and items that were donated and secondhand and not wanted. And the state government had to set up a sort of cluster just to manage all of the donated items. So I don't have an easy solution to that, but I think actually, Aninia, this is a point that should be mentioned in the next revision of the Sphere Handbook, because in urban centers where access is easy, this is a very real and a very costly challenge. The Victorian fires that happened in Melbourne, they have been able to calculate in the millions of dollars how much government had to spend on clearing donated goods.
Thank you. Thank you, Pam. I will, if there's no one else who wants to speak to this one, or you can speak to this one later as well, once you're speaking, I have another quite long and complex comment here. There are, says this listener, there are really three untackled issues. The first one is the lack of an effective transition between dependency and independency in terms of livelihoods. We heard about livelihoods several times in today's presentations. So from dependency to independency, the support element, I guess that would be probably something that Schumann can talk to as well. The second issue is the existing markets incapacity to absorb the prepared and trained individuals, creating pressure and tension between different vulnerable groups, locals, migrants, and refugees. Those are two elements, actually. That absorbing the trained individuals is probably what the previous question also also brought up, is how do you bring in all those specialists who come in and also want to support the response. And the different vulnerable groups, the competition among different vulnerable groups is an important issue that maybe Schumann or Camille could talk to. And the third element is the effect of urban flows between city-town settings, open loops of circularity, and materials and resources waste. That's maybe a question for David, if I may. So the first one was the lack of effective transition between dependency and independency. Schumann, you want to talk to this one?
I better be talking about the creating pressure or tension between different vulnerable groups.
Go for it.
Because in Dhaka experience that I have been talking about, the particular slum fire, livelihood is not necessarily an response there, because people lost their kind of the shelter and the asset. But as the slum dwellers work around the city, so not necessarily they lost their livelihood, maybe paused for some days, and that's where actually food distribution happened there. So all those happen based on the, as I said, a need assessment on the ground involving the community. And if you allow me, just linking this with the third issue of creating pressure and tension between different vulnerable groups. Yes, there is always everyone affected by a disaster, any emergency. Everyone wants support. And that's where actually Sphere Standard came in. When we have limited resources for responding, it is the prioritizing the who are the most vulnerable. And the prioritization can be done by the community first. They know who in their community is the most vulnerable and need the support first. So, and that's where those Sphere Standard in selections, Sphere Standard in prioritization, involving community, this coming here. And when we involve community, particularly those local government on selecting the term, quote unquote, the beneficiaries for support. It's help reducing the tension and minimizing the tension, and people understand the reality on the ground. So that's why I always recommend, at least if we can ensure the standards in terms of need assessment, in terms of involvement communities, in terms of prioritizing the vulnerable groups and vulnerabilities, it is helpful on the ground and it is impactful at the end result. Thank you.
Thank you, Schumann. Any other responses to the questions we just brought up?
Yeah, I just can say that it is also something that we realized, and we really need to understand that in the current context, it is very difficult for all of us to differentiate between the emergency and the long-term support or the development, let's say. Because, I mean, most of the people are considering that Sphere standards is a document that is supporting for the emergencies. And I mean, in essence, yes, it is true that in most of the contexts we can use the Sphere standards in emergencies. But what I can say is when we are discussing about livelihood, it is part of the development, and we are still using, and we really need to still use the Sphere standards in that sense as well. And I mean, this is transition from dependence to independence is a part that we understand, a process that is leading us, addressing us to the resilience work that we all really need to focus on. And what we understand from Sphere is it is a guiding document and a supporting document for us to use the intersectoral approach with the core principles, at least. And in the urban settings, this is also something that we are using and we really need to use as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Camille. Thank you very much. This actually responds to a certain extent to, I have to another comment that says, well, we do know what we need to do. We would like to know how to do it. And it comes back to what are standards. Standards tell you what should be done in order for people to recover with dignity. There is a little bit of a how-to in the guidance notes, but essentially you need to appropriate those to your own context. And the two guides give some how-to, especially the second one specifically on the various technical chapters. It goes into elements you need to consider. There is the afterwards, it's up to each organization or individual organization ideally to actually operationalize and integrate that guidance into your own guidance. There's another comment that says the principles of partnership should be included in Sphere. That is a very valid point. We take that. It may happen at some other point. Right now, it's not in they're not in the Sphere handbook, but it's a very important issue. How to work in partnership. And there is another question. In urban settings, there are a lot of informal settlers too, which make applying shelter and settlement provision a challenge, and adhering to standards due to limited spaces. That to me, again, is a contextual challenge to which the indicators need to be adapted. I will leave it at that, but I'm happy for one of the panelists to pick up that issue. There's another question. What is the best guidance about how to coordinate humanitarian operations and informal settlement slums upgrading activities? Maybe that one can go to Schumann and David, because it's true that many slum situations are actually in themselves humanitarian catastrophes, and so should be responded to as well, and the Sphere standards should be able to help with that. And if I may, I'll just continue. One last question. How soon will these urban standards be advocated to country policy standards when working in urban emergencies? Adapting international standards and guidelines to local, to national level is something that is crucial. That's part of what the first guide actually develops, is talking about adapting international standards in national settings. And one last, and then I'll stop. The author of the first guide, Ben Mountfield, says, in urban settings, big, dense, highly monetized, humanitarian actors have much less relative power than in rural areas. How can humanitarians, with their reduced voice, effectively advocate for the adoption of Sphere standards, a people-centered, rights-based approach with the local authorities during or before a crisis? That lines up with the first one. It is how to give a voice to the Sphere approach and to a humanitarian approach in urban settings. Maybe that one is for David.
Yes, happy to jump in. I've been reading the thank you Ben for that. Couldn't agree more. I've just been reading some of the stuff that's been going, and also talking about informal settlements. Perhaps I could just comment on that one, because it was Catherine Larakis. I'm sorry if I said that wrong, and what you're saying, Rick, as well. This is a real conundrum. Close to 1 billion people living in low-income settlements, as some of many of which are informal, and that may well grow an awful lot in the next 2 decades if you and Habitat's only half right, and they're almost certainly going to be fully right. It's a real conundrum, right? You get a disaster, a crisis, and a national government or a city government might see that as a reason to get rid of people, or a large NGO might not be given permissions to work in those areas because those people are illegal. And so you get this catch-22 of illegal people who are also probably among the most vulnerable, they're always more vulnerable, among the most vulnerable, not being allowed to be helped by those whose mandated it is to help. And so all kinds of wriggle room goes around and things happen, and some people are helped and a lot of people aren't, of course. As we know, the best it gets often is to meet a small proportion of people's genuine need in any response. It's obviously a myth that everybody gets helped by supporting authorities and aid agencies. And then other people might get relocated, but that's the long-term work that's being done, I suppose, in development and economic gains and all those complexities. But if there was ever a mire of complexity, it is informal settlements and disasters and how to respond and do those things. Touching on Ben's comment, yeah, I'm rather pleased that external actors have less power, because they're external actors. And so if the role is more support than provide, and actually going along with those existing governance structures, which may range from being absolutely dreadful to absolutely wonderful, and often at the further end of the not so good, because there is a correlation of governance, corruption and disasters, which is very strong, in fact, then our role is to support that. Support as much as we can, knowing it's informal. I'm saying nothing you don't know already, I know that. But that's part of the complexity of the situation that we're facing.
Thank you, David. I have two more comments, questions that I would like to mention, and then hand over to each of you for a last round of responding to the comments we've heard and wrapping up this question answer session, which clearly has been a bit short given the interest and the questions that came in. One was, no, not every urban setting is a humanitarian emergency. There are standards thresholds being developed or have been developed on when a slum situation can be considered a humanitarian emergency. I'm sure Schumann could speak more to that. The other question was, is there training for humanitarians to learn how to work in urban settings? That's a broad, important question. Training for humanitarian work is always important, and this specific sector as well, of course, in this specific context. There is some training out there. David will have more information on that also, I'm sure, and more training is certainly needed. So that's a very valid point. And the last point I want to mention is there a way to move from immediate help to a more future-oriented way of approaching urban settings, humanitarian response in urban settings? That is very important. That goes along with training, that goes along with preparedness and with having a vision, since urban settings change so much, having a vision for the long term. So those are the last few comments I wanted to throw out there. And may I suggest that we wrap up in response to these comments and in general along the same lines as we started. So over to you, Camille, for a last round of comments and response. Thank you.
Thank you, Anina. So I mean, it seems that there are various questions that in our minds, and it really been effective and fruitful webinar for me as well, because I had various notes from your questions and queries and comments as well. So what we understand from from the urban settlement response is we are not actually facing with too many emergency cases, but how we are responding to the long-term development is not very different from how we are responding to emergencies in general. So this is why we think that Sphere is an essential guideline that that we can benefit for all sectors. I mean, not just for the core humanitarian principles or the protection principles, let's say, but also for the sectoral areas that there are a lot of tools that we can benefit for the long-term development activities as well. So, I mean, it is obvious that we need to revisit how we are responding on the field level. And also, it is also important for all of us to understand the paradigmal change within the sector after that COVID, and most probably we will be facing with climate change. So that I think there will be more changes, and we really need to understand that these are all normal things now. I mean, we will be facing these, and we will try to embrace it with the knowledge that we developed all together.
Thank you. Thank you, Camille. We are running over time. I'm just hoping that you will bear with us for another few minutes as I hand over for last remarks to Zeynep, please.
Thank you, Aninia. And thank you. It was really useful meeting for me too. And it is really nice for getting different reflections from different contexts. I would like to focus one point, providing training or introductory information on severe minimum standards to the humanitarian workers. Actually, not only severe minimum standards, humanitarian partnership standards. I think there is really big need because of just my small research with the humanitarian workers in Istanbul. You know, this is the mega city, and there are international organizations, national organizations, UN agencies, And there is huge response to the Syrian refugees. And there are a huge community working in here as a humanitarian aid workers, but just limited part of these totally aware what is the Sphere standards. Just they are saying, okay, my organization is applying it and I need to learn more. So I think this is one of the homework for all of us for providing some opportunities to the humanitarian aid workers in all contexts. I am stopping here. Thank you.
Thank you, Zeynep. Very important remarks indeed. Schumann, may I ask you for your last words on this topic in this webinar?
Thank you very much. And again, I would be starting from the last sentence that my colleague said, just said, that a humanitarian work is a professional work. And things can be done professionally. So there is difference. And over last couple of decades, from a very kind of a disorganized humanitarian discourse, we are gradually getting more informative, structured, coordinated emergency response, disaster risk reduction, and everything. So what I'm trying to say, this disaster risk reduction, humanitarian response is an emergency discourse of professional skills. And it is important that people develop this as professional skill. Anybody can do it, but some people can do it professionally. So there come it the capacity building of humanitarian responders, particularly those, the frontline workers, the local aid workers. Recently, in last year, our Humanitarian Leadership Academy Bangladesh undertake a learning need assessment in Cox's Bazar, you know, this Rohingya emergency sector. And we talked around 450 aid workers, and we found that very young group of people just coming out from universities, college, or moving from another sector, starting running, staged, and everything, but do not have enough knowledge about the humanitarian response skills, which is particularly core humanitarian standard is promoting core humanitarian competency framework. So it is important we as a community of humanitarian aid worker, we need to stress and demand this is a professional skill, and this professional skill actually ultimately impact on the vulnerable people's life. So it is important as we support people for their food or emergency need. Thank you.
Thank you, Schumann. That's a really important issue. The whole professionalization skill sets humanitarian workers, and to really not underestimate the importance to understand what we're actually doing in order to not do more harm than good. Very briefly, we're starting to lose people here who need to go to next calls. David, over to you for your last reflections.
20 seconds. Awesome. Aid itself is currently urbanizing. Right now we have a system that some might say was rather bloated and ill-suited to the urban world of things and what we need to do. In the future, smaller, nimbler, more flexible, more supportive.
Woo, awesome. That was quick. Pamela, over to you.
I'll try to match that. A reflection from government is from Bangladesh to Australia, municipalities lack experience in huge disasters. And so I wonder if policies and standards can maybe be tied somehow to the Sendai framework and somehow to the National Disaster Management Agencies who are responsible for coordinating this stuff. Over.
Thank you. Thank you, Pam. And that's a great way for me to end with an opening to future things that Sphere intends to work on, which is specifically on linking the Sphere standards more to NDMA's work. And there's also a DRR guidance out there now Sphere, and that makes a direct link to the Sendai framework. We hear you, and those are a good, very important few leads for us to move on. I want to draw this conversation to a close. I want to thank hugely all five participants, all five speakers, and the audience for a really engaged discussion. I want to thank my colleagues Barbara Sartore and Wasila Mansouri for their support in making this webinar happen in the first place. It wouldn't have without them, very clearly. And I'm hoping that we can actually produce a couple of things out of this wealth of information that we've gathered today. You will hear from us. Please, if you want to know what's happening with Sphere, go and subscribe to our newsletter or go to our website and get in touch with us, spherestandards.org. That's where the website is. Again, thank you. Have a good evening, good afternoon, good rest of the morning, wherever you are, and hope to see you again soon. Thank you. Bye.
Good night, everyone. Bye-bye.
Good night.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you, Tol. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you so much for the training.
Thank you.
All right. Bye. All right, then.
Thank you all. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye to...
To the speakers, if you would like to keep connected and have a very quick debrief, otherwise it's also fine if you have to go.